Today, Department of Chemistry is organizing the webinar on the topic Nonlinear Optics and Application. So, on behalf of the college and management, I invite you all to the program. Let's start the program with a prayer.
தெய்வமே காத்து கொள்ளுங்க கைவிடாதீங்கு ஞங்களே நாவிகன் நீ பவாதிக்க ஒராவி வந்தோணி நின்பதும் ஒன்னொன்னாய் எண்ணி எண்ணி தொட்டெண்ணும் பொருளொடுங்கியால் நின்னிடும் திருக்கு போலுள்ளம் நின்னில ஸ்பந்தமாகணும் അന്നവസ്ത്രാദി മുട്ടാതെ തന്നു രക്ഷിച്ചു ഞങ്ങളെ ധന്യരാക്കുന്ന നീയുന്നു തന്നെ ഞങ്ങൾക്കു തമ്പുരാൻ ആഴിയും തിരയും കാറ്റും ആഴവും പോലെ ഞങ്ങളും മായയും നിന്മഹിമയും നീയുമെന്നുള്ളിലാകണം നീയല്ലോ സൃഷ്ടിയും സൃഷ്ടാവായതും സൃഷ്ടിജാലവും നീയല്ലോ ദൈവമേ സൃഷ്ടിക്കുള്ള സാമഗ്രിയായതും നീയല്ലോ മായയും മായാവിയും മായാവിനോദനും നീയല്ലോ മായയെ നീക്കി സായൂജ്യം നൽകുമാരനും നീ സത്യം ജയിക്കുക മഹാദേവ ദീനാവന പരായണ ജയിക്കുക ചിദാനന്ദ ദയാ സിന്ധോ ജയിക്കുക ആഴമേറും നിൻ മഹസ്സ ആഴിയങ്ങളാകവേ ആഴണം വാഴണം നിത്യം വാഴണം വാഴണം സുഖം
Good
afternoon to each one of you present today. It is a moment of extreme pleasure to welcome you all who are present here to attend the seminar. On behalf of KR Sri Narayana College and Dishna 2021, I offer my regards to all the people joining us. I convey my regards to the resource person of the day, Ms. Anaga Sabu. Thank you for accepting our invitation and coming over for the seminar. I also want to offer my regards to our principal, Dr. Anil. Further, I would like to welcome Ms. Aghila, Dr. Arya, and Ms. Nuha, and all the people who work in the background. Thank you to everyone who made this seminar series possible with their opinions and views, especially Dr. Jidin, head of the Department of Physics, who took the helm of this seminar series. The schedule of the seminar will focus on nonlinear optics and its applications. At last, once again, a warm welcome to all the people in this meeting. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Next, I invite Mrs. Aghila Singh for the presidential address. Ma'am, please.
Hi, good afternoon to all. I feel honored to be here as the organizer of Chemistry Department webinar, and I feel happy to be a part of this multidisciplinary international webinar series, Dishana 2021, in association with Kerala State Higher Educational Council. Today, As per the request, Ms. Anagha Sabu, research scholar from Australian National University, Australia, is joined here to give a wonderful session based on the topic nonlinear optics and its application. It is the branch of optics that describes the behavior of light in nonlinear media. The research aim is to prepare new types of potentially useful circular orbitons and understand how particle structure can control particular properties is a key step, and this necessitates coupling synthesis to a range of physical property studies. As the head of the Department of Chemistry, I would like to express the deep sense of gratitude to all of your wholehearted presence that wasted your valuable time and intellect. Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am. Now, we are moving on to our session. It is time to invite our guest at Australian National University, Australia.
Thank you. Thank you, Akhila. Thank you, sir, for the invitation and the welcome speech. I'm so glad to present just a part of my work in this webinar. So let's get into it. So let me share my screen. Yeah. So I guess it's afternoon there. So a warm good afternoon to everyone. So I'm Anagha Sabu. I'm working under the supervision of Professor Mark Humphrey from Australian National University, Australia. So Mark is one of the giant in this nonlinear optical chemistry. So we basically work in the synthetic part. We synthesize molecules which has a peculiar nonlinear optical application. So the picture here is our laser laboratory. So I just took the picture from there and just put it in the slide. So let's begin with the introduction. So what I'm going to do is for the people who are not much aware about this field, so tell you a little bit about the basic phenomena in this field, the origin of nonlinear optical effects, and walk you a little bit through the applications and how we design the molecules. So let's just start with the linear optical polarizability. I hope we all might have studied at least in our higher classes or in the first semester of our undergraduate. So the polarizability, the term itself refers to the tendency of a matter when subjected to an electric field to acquire an electric dipole moment in proportion to the applied electric field. So when subject to an oscillating electric field, the negatively charged electrons and the positive nuclei are subject to opposite forces and they will undergo a charge separation. So as I given in the slide, so we can do a simple plot of the induced polarization, the dipole moment in the case of a molecule as a function of applied field. And it will be linear plot if the molecule is having a simple linear restoring force for the electrons around the molecule. So at the molecular level, we can write the equation that describes the polarization which is happening in the molecule as the new induced is alpha E, whereas the alpha is the polarizability and E is for the electric field. So in the bulk level, we can write the polarization density as the first order susceptibility, which is related to the dielectric constant and the refractive index of the material. So now the real issue is, not all material responds linearly with electric field. So there are materials, or we can synthesize materials that can respond non-linearly towards the incidenting electric field. So there is a significant deviation of the plot of induced dipole moment versus that of the electric field in that case. So we all know, like, when a light is incidenting on a material, a lot of interaction can happen there. It may be resonant, non-resonant, linear, non-linear. It may absorb, it may refractive, that may be refractive or absorptive or reversible or irreversible. So all these sort of things can, scenarios can happen in a material when it is being hit by a light. So as you can see in the plot, which is given between the linear optics and the nonlinear optics, the input wave and the emitted wave coming out of the material is almost similarly, it's which is the same in the case of the linear optics. Whereas in the case of the nonlinear material can change the color of the light wave, the wavelength is different, the frequency is different. So basically the properties of the light which is coming out of a nonlinear material is different. So the light can alter its frequency as it passes through a nonlinear optical material. So this nonlinear optical effect is not only possible, is only possible with an intense light beam. So here comes the importance of a laser beam, where I already shown a picture of our laser lab. So we use a femtosecond laser. So here is the importance of the laser. So we need a very intense electric field to produce this nonlinear optical effect. So a nonlinear optical material can change the electromagnetic components of the incident beam. So in order to describe that, basically we use a Taylor series expansion. I haven't given that entire equation, that may be very much complicated for undergraduate students. So I haven't put the entire Taylor series expansion. I just simplified the equation and I have given the basic nonlinear equation for when.
Excuse me, madam. Can you please show the slides? Can you please move the slides?
Yes. Can you see the slides?
Yes, but the second, third ones are not visible. Now the slide is in nonlinear optics and application, that heading is showing.
Okay. Oh, what do you see in right now?
Sorry.
Oh, okay. Can you see, are you seeing the first slide right now?
Yes, yes, we are seeing the first slide only.
Okay, what about now?
Sorry.
Can you see the second slide right now?
No, no. Still, it is in nonlinear optics that the heading is showing. If you move the slide, I think you can click the second slide, so it will be visible. Yes, yes. Now it's okay. Yes. Now we are seeing introduction.
Oh, so.
Okay. Do you can I know? Thank you.
So do I need to present it like this?
Yes, 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 right. So that we can easily capture the points.
Okay, I thought you can already see when
I'm no problem, no problem, madam. You can go ahead. Okay, thank you.
Okay, fine, yeah. So you guys haven't seen this slide at all?
Yes, madam, yes. No problem, you can proceed now. You can proceed.
Oh, okay, fine, yeah. So I was actually, I suppose you guys haven't seen the slide, so let me explain that one more time. So when a light is incidenting on a material, the material can respond in different ways. So here is a comparison of a linear optics and a nonlinear optic and how the light wave is behaving when it is hitting on a nonlinear material and a linear material. So in linear optics, as I already said, the wave which is coming out of the material is almost the same. The color is the same and the wavelength is the same. But when it comes to the nonlinear material, the wave which is coming out of the molecule is having a different color, a different wavelength frequency. So this is basically what is happening in the case of a nonlinear optical material. So when it's hit by a very intense laser beam, the material can change the properties of the light wave and it can show a very significant nonlinear optical properties, and that can be correlated to a vast variety also of applications in optics. So here is the chemistry that happening in the polarization terms of a material when it is having a nonlinear optical property. So basically, which is a Taylor series expansion. So what I was saying was I haven't put the entire Taylor Swift expansion because that will make things a bit complicated. So I just made it simple and just given the basic equation of the for the polarization in nonlinear optics. So we can expand the dipole moment as a functional field, and you can have the linear term, which is the alpha e, and then you have terms that scale quadratically and cubically with the electric field. And these terms are referred to as nonlinear polarization terms. They give rise to interesting effects, which I describe briefly. And they can be used for things like switching generation of new frequencies by using lasers. And we are interested in understanding how we can make molecules to generate these properties, which is this nonlinear optical properties. In this case, it's referred to as the first hyperpolarizability for the term that is quadratic in electric field, and second hyperpolarizability for the term that is cubic in electric field. The things that are quadratic in the field will be showing second order nonlinear optical effect, and cubic will be showing third order nonlinear optical effects. So that represent the chi2 and the chi3. So this is a simple formulation of the nonlinear optics. So the chi2 represent a material which is having a second order optical effect, which is a chi2 material. For example, the second harmonic generations, and the chi3 represents the third order effect, which is the material which is showing a third order nonlinear optical effect, which is a chi3 material. So I put the equation to generally that we have to take into account that each of these coefficients are frequency dependent. So about the second harmonic generation, so here is a beam of light omega enters the material, which is a chi2 material, which is having a second order nonlinear optical response, and some fraction of light gets converted to frequency omega and frequency 2 omega. So in a simple quantum mechanical process in which two photons are simultaneously extracted from the input laser beam, and a single photon is created, which is having the same frequency. And when it comes to the third harmonic generation, the same story happening. Three different photons, each having omega, is simultaneously annihilated, and a photon of frequency harmonic generation. And when it comes to higher orders, we can just generate multi-photon absorptions and all. I am not quite sure if you have already learned in your second semester or something about the Frank-Condon principle. So the diagram in the right-hand side represents the Frank-Condon principle, the phi-level diagram. What is the mechanism happening in the material in terms of electrons? What happens in the material when a material is hit by a light wave? So I guess you all are familiar about this, because when a light is hit on a material, the electrons from the ground state will be excited to the higher energy levels. So we can say, which is S1, S2, T1, T2, depending upon the spin multiplicity, we can just, there are different energy levels. So basically, when an electron gets a sufficient threshold amount of energy, it can jump from a lower energy level to a higher energy level. So in case of nonlinear optics, since the light beam is sufficiently strong enough, it can excite multiple photons at the same time. So that may be 2-photon absorption, 3-photon absorption, 4-photon absorption. Research groups have represented or published up to 6-photon absorption till now. So that's the maximum that has generated up to this date. So what's happening when these photons are being hit by this material? So the electrons will be jumping from this lower S0 to the S1 or maybe S2, and the higher energy levels will be more populated than compared to the ground state. So an electron cannot actually stay in a higher energy level for a long time. So it will undergo relaxation. It will come back to the ground state. Maybe it will come from S2 to S1, then from S1 to T1, then from T1 to S0. So depending upon the type of relaxation, there comes the fluorescence, phosphorescence, this kind of phenomena can occur. So this is what is happening when a light is incidenting on a material. When it comes to nonlinear optics, the absorption of electron will not be just one electron, it will be a multiple electrons. So that's basically the mechanism which is happening in the nonlinear optics. So let me go in detail about the second order nonlinear optical effect. So as I already said, the second order nonlinear optical effect is a very spontaneous process involving the transition between two states. And it is symmetry restricted and not observed in molecules or materials which is having a center of inversion or a center of inversion symmetry. Talking about the strategy, the most successful strategy for designing a molecule which is having efficient second order property is the dipolar approach. This molecular design involves basically the linear compounds which is containing an electron donor and an electron acceptor functional group to terminals, which is connected through a highly conjugated pi bridge, which is in order to maximize the polarization on the molecular axis in the excited state and so enhances the hyperpolarizability. So here the two-level model assumes a polar ground state and a charge-separated first excited state, where beta is related to the energy of transition, which is the Emax, and the transition dipole moment, nu Eg, between the two states. So this equation indicates that properties of molecule can be optimized by increasing the dipole moment of the excited state or by reducing the energy of transition. That is, reducing the energy of homo-lumo gap so that a molecule can easily jump between the two states. That is basically the requirement for the second order nonlinear optical molecules. So as you can see in this example, there is a donor, metals, the ruthenium. We usually work with ruthenium attached compounds. So here the ruthenium will act as a donor and the nitro group will act as an acceptor. And in between, the aromatic chain will act as a pi bridge. So there will be a effective communication along the length of this molecular axis. Next is the third order nonlinear optical effect. So when it comes to third order nonlinearities, which is not symmetry dependent, and the third order nonlinear coefficient gamma is defined by a real and an imaginary component. The real component of the cubic nonlinearity is related to the nonlinear refractive index of the material and describe the ability of a material to focus the incident light, and which will result in a beam of higher or lower intensity that we call it as, Kerr effect. So the imaginary component, which is related to the nonlinear absorption properties, like two-photon absorption in higher orders, which is known as multi-photon absorption. And about a specific strategy, the design strategy is less known in terms of the cubic nonlinearity compared to the second-order nonlinear optics. Usually we generate molecules depending upon the dipolar approach, quadrupolar, octopolar molecules, and we check whether it's having a third order nonlinear optical property using our femtosecond lasers. So several classes of active structures have been extracted for this particular property that possess the same characteristics as I said before, like the polarizable pi electrons, low energy intramolecular charge transfer, but they differ in the nature of their multipolar charge distribution. So one of the most prominent one is the two donor, two acceptor separated by a unsaturated pi delocalized bridge. So I would like to talk a bit more about the absorption phenomena, which is the multiple photon absorption. So relying on the advantage of the femtosecond lasers, which is having high directionality, high brightness, and it can produce very strong laser beams. So nowadays, people are actually struggling to get up to six photon absorption or up to six order properties. So even my project is basically to produce or synthesize molecules which is having up to a six photon absorption. So here is the schematic description of an elementary multiphoton induced molecular transition process. So the solid line represent the real state and the dashed line represent the virtual or the imaginary state. So when it comes to two photon absorption, which is the simultaneous absorption of two photons, so the molecular transition can be visualized as a two-step event. In the first step, one photon is absorbed while the molecule leaves its initial state, which is the Eg, to the excited state, to an intermediate state, which is sometimes called a virtual state. And in the second step, another photon will be absorbed while the same molecule completes its first transition from the intermediate state to the final state. So similarly, a three photon absorption will occur, simultaneous absorption of three photons of a single molecule. So similar description, same story happens in case of four photon absorption, five photon absorption. So the number of intermediate state will be changing. So there will be more number of intermediate states when we go to higher order nonlinearities. So as a chemist, what are the challenges for synthesizing these kind of molecules? So comes to the synthetic part, we know like the polyacetylene, which is more polarizable than butane, right? There is a lot of pi electrons in it. So the semiconductors are more polarizable than insulator. So there is a conductivity there. So the extent of delocalization or how we can establish a communication is the key factor, and which is related to the linear polarizability. So what we're trying to do is synthesizing molecules which is effective in producing a very strong electric current towards the entire molecule, or what you call a better communication between the entire molecule length. So when it comes to organic molecule, how we can establish this communication? The key is electron delocalization. We need the electron to talk. We need the electron to go around, play around, communicate between each other. So then only we will be getting better application out of the molecules that we are synthesizing. That we can achieve only by the number of orbitals, the electrons. If there is more number of orbitals, there will be more overlapping, so the electrons can go around the entire molecule easily. And the second factor is the hybridization of the orbitals. So there is sp hybridization, sp2 hybridization. So depends upon the hybridization which is happening there. So for example, an sp and an sp2 orbital cannot overlap well, but two sp orbitals can overlap well, because they are in same direction, same kind of orbitals. So there comes a better communication and the degree of coupling between these orbitals. So basically, we try to establish a better conjugated molecules separated by a strong donor and a strong acceptor, work can establish this better communication. So here is one example, one simple example we can I can show you is, just consider this molecule. There's an electron withdrawing group. There is a conjugated bridge. There is an electron donating group. So there is a charge separation is happening in the molecule. There is a strong molecular dipole is there. So the electron withdrawing group is there and an electron donating group is there. So if the electron donating group is strong enough, it will give away the electrons, and the electron accepting, electron withdrawing groups can accept those electrons. So there is a communication. So at one point, electron is coming and there is somebody else is waiting at the other end, so he can accept the electrons. So this is the strategy that we basically use in order to establish this communication between our molecules. So comes to the real part of nonlinear optical effects. So the coming to the real part of nonlinear optics, we all, for example, we all crave for bandwidth, especially during the lockdown period, right? So the bandwidth, the definition itself is basically the amount of information that we can, per unit area, per unit time that we can send through a cable. So if you communicate via light, you can get much high bandwidth and you can avoid having to convert light signal to electric signals back and forth, and you can use less electricity, right? So in order to do that, we need to manipulate light. So this here in the left-hand side is a Chi3 material working on the real part of Chi3. So the way it converts is you can imagine splitting light into two paths, and they can recombine. They can recombine two types in two ways, constructively and destructively. So in one arm of this little device, which is the Maxon interferometer, we can change the index of refraction. You will accumulate a phase shift. And what that means, if you change that index of refraction enough to accumulate a 180 degree phase shift, we can get destructive interference. So what you can do is you can take an optical signal, and then you can take a pulse of light, which this third order material, and that pulse of light will change the refractive index of the material. So when you do that, you can control whether you have constructive or destructive interference, and you can modulate the light at very, very high frequency. The next is the application of the second order Chi2 material. The second picture describes the two photon absorption microscopy. So when we shine two photons of light, you can get a spatial confinement of where you get excitation in a very, very small spatial volume right at the focus of the laser beam. So the origin of this is very simple. As I already said in the beginning of my talk, the first photon, one photon absorption, the linear polarizability, that scales linearly with the intensity of light, where the two photon absorption, that scales quadratically. That means two photon has to reach the molecule at the same time. So for that, we need a laser beam. So we need to consider a laser beam and its intensity. As you move away from the focus, the intensity falls quadratically with distance, which means the two photon absorption probability falls off a fourth power of distance. So here there is two objective shining light into a cuvette full of dye here. The objective at left shining blue light give rise to one photon absorption. The light has absorbed through the entire path of beam traveled through the sample. So that is one photon absorption. That is directly proportional to intensity. The objective at the right hand side is twice that wavelength. So here, the only place show fluorescence is that tiny little spot. The only one place where the laser intensity is strong enough to give rise to simultaneous absorption of two photons instead of one. So that is the real strength of two photon excitation, is that there is no out of focus light. We are only getting excitation in the region where the beam is very intense and more tightly focused, where we need. So in case of high resolution, this two photon microscopy is very, very useful compared to the normal microscopes that we use. So this is one of the few examples of the nonlinear optical materials and why we synthesize these kind of molecules. So almost that's up to my talk. So thank you all. So this is my group and my colleagues and my professor, Professor Mark Humphrey. This is our school, the Research School of Chemistry. We are just sitting in front of our school. So thank you. Thank you all.
Okay, so I think it is time to wind up the session. I now invite Dr. Arya Mishra for the vote of thanks. Ma'am, please.
Okay, good evening to you all. Honorable dignitaries, distinguished guests, respected principal, and here participants, on behalf of K.R. Srinarayana College, it is an entire fraternity and organizing committee, I feel immense pleasure to take this opportunity to propose the vote of thanks to our eminent personality, Ms. Anakha Sabu, researcher, Australian National University, who is the time being scheduled to grace this webinar with extremely relevant topic on nonlinear optics and applications. And further, I extend my words to hearty thanks to Dr. Anil B., principal of K.R. Srinarayana College, for always encouraging us and providing opportunity to organizing such events. And I take this opportunity to especially express my deep regards and gratitudes to Ms. Akhila, Department of Chemistry, for her speechless effort. I would especially thank our organizing secretary, Dr. Jidin, for his unflattering supports and confidences. My deep sense of appreciation and thanks to all the participants who chose to be live with us and attend the webinar with great enthusiasm and make it a successful event. Last, surely not the least, I would like to express my sincere thanks to Mr. Srini and Mrs. Rahimat and Dubey sir from Computer Science for their technical supports. Thank you so much.
Okay, thank you, ma'am. Now, let us wind up the session with a national anthem.